I want to thank you, Lord, for letting me belong. I'm just one-fourth of one small group that sings your songs. I know that there are others who have served in bigger ways. All I can do is sing your music all my days. It makes me grateful just to know that I can be unique and fill a spot beside the other three. Without a place here in the church, I know that I'd be lost. Thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause.
Oh, I may never stand like old Elijah stood, but standing on your promises is just as good. And I may never be a heavy or a great, but you've given me the strength to pull my weight.
Oh, for this part I sing is truly part of me, and it does its part to lock the other parts in key, and it does its part to make me think now as I pause, to thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause.
It makes me grateful just to know that I can be unique and fill a spot beside the other three. Without a place here in the church, I know that I'd be lost. Thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause.
Oh, Lord, you've given me a place that I call mine, though I've stepped out of it and I've gotten out of line. Sometimes I sing your music slightly out of key, and I know I make it harder for the other three.
Oh, I've always done my part the very best I could, and it's done the other guys a world of good. I want to sing your praise, Lord, preach about your laws. Thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause.
It makes me grateful just to know that I can be unique and fill a spot beside the other three. Without a place here in the church, I know that I'd be lost. Thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause. Without a place here in the church, I know that I'd be lost. Thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause.
Bum, bum, bum.
Thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause.
Welcome to our service at Quaker Avenue for Sunday, May 24th. We're glad you decided to join us this morning. Before we get started, I wanted to share something this morning about a conversation I had with a friend this week. We were talking about suffering and how we struggle to understand it and trying to figure out what we do with it. Our first inclination, I think, is when we suffer or when any of our friends are suffering, is we just want it to stop. But what makes suffering so hard is that we can rarely, if ever, have anything to do with really making the suffering stop. So this morning, I know that a lot of us are struggling, and I wanted to take a minute just to acknowledge the reality of the suffering that all of us are going through. And even more specifically, I wanted to acknowledge that each one of us are really going through our own individual suffering. I can sense it and I can feel it. I'm not sure if you can, but there's something where I can just feel the hurt. And for those who are suffering, I just want to acknowledge that, and I want you to know that you're not alone. But I don't want to leave it there. Suffering is real, but it's not just something we tolerate when we are going through life. It's not just a necessary evil. Suffering is mysteriously meaningful. And Paul talks to us about this in Romans 5, where he says that suffering produces perseverance and character and hope. So what I feel like Paul is telling us is that hope is hidden in our suffering. And this is not the kind of hope that just says, well, all suffering is meaningless and I just want it to stop. It's the kind of hope that says, I really don't understand this suffering, but there's something deep inside of me that tells me that there is a purpose in it. So this is the kind of hope that doesn't disappoint us. And so, again, I want to acknowledge, I understand and I know that there's a lot of suffering going on out there, but there's also a great hope that's hidden within that suffering. And so I encourage you to take hope in that. So before we begin our service this morning, I'd like you to pray with me. Father, we are all struggling with this situation and the circumstances that we find ourselves in today. It can be very lonely. It can be very isolating. But yet, we can always take heart in knowing that you are always doing something meaningful in our lives. No matter what is happening, no matter what we are experiencing, no matter what level of suffering we are going through, we can have hope because of the love that you have poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. So, Father, we thank you for that love. And I pray for each one of us this morning that you would fill us with that hope and fill us with that love. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. The time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of my salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God. spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of my salvation, and renew a right spirit within me.
Let's pray together. Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Father, we thank you for sending Jesus. And Jesus, we thank you for being willing to come, to live, to die, and to send the Holy Spirit now that lives in us to reflect your glory on this earth. And God, we want to place all things in proper perspective. We don't want to lessen the sufferings, the hurts, even as Chuck mentioned in the opening of the suffering that many are going through and that many will go through. We don't want to ignore that or lessen it, but we want to put it all in the perspective that you're supreme over all those things and you're working through those things. And we do want to proclaim with our mouths, with our intellect, that you are supreme. Help us to feel in our heart and to truly believe that in all things you do have the supremacy. In the spite of our fears and our doubts, our anxieties, even in our praise and our great days, God, help our eyes to turn to you. Father, even as we've sung, that you will create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us. And don't cast us away from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from us, God. So please cover us with your Holy Spirit, even now in the different homes as we meet, as we listen to this, as we praise together. Just help us to always feel the presence of your Spirit convicting us, God prompting us, consoling us, comforting us, connecting us, even across so many different distances. God, we just want to put our confidence, our trust in you. We also do want to be aware of each other, those that are going through difficult times right now, health-wise, spiritual ailments that we all suffer from. So we place them before you and ask you to heal us. But again, God, we just want to give you the proper honor that you're due as much as we can, and fill us up with more and more faith every day. And God, help us not to be the same. Help us to continue to change more and more to be like Jesus. And thank you for being with us and dwelling with us. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I will never be the same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk the path. I'll run the race, and I will never be the same again. Fall like fire, soak like rain, flow like mighty waters again and again. Sweep away the darkness, burn away the chaff, and let a flame burn to glorify your name. I will never be the same again. I can never return. I close the door. I will walk the path. I'll run the race. Never. the same again. For like fire, soak like rain, flow like mighty waters again and again. Sweep away the darkness, burn away the chaff, and let a flame burn to glorify your name. And let a flame burn to glorify your name. There are higher heights, there are deeper seas. Whatever you need to do, Lord, do in me. The glory of God fills my life.
I have absolutely loved the online services during this time of being homebound due to the pandemic. I've also certainly missed the in-person singing, the in-person instruction, the preaching, and of course, getting to see everyone. But I want to share with you just a little bit about this time in the service, the Lord's Supper. I actually love the Lord's Supper at home. And I think I've grown more to appreciate the Lord's Supper at home. So hear me out before you say, oh my goodness, the Lord's Supper was meant to commune and in large groups. While I understand that, it has helped me in my heart, and I'm going to explain why. So I certainly miss the in-person of church, but take a look at the Lord's Supper from my perspective and from your perspective, being at home. I certainly want to thank Sid and Blaine Sexton for gathering all the communion photos. And when I see those photos, I see bread, I see cup, I see an intimate setting. And that's where I'm going with this. This in-person, at-home communion has caused me to become more intimate with God, because there's only two of us. It's Christy and myself. My mother-in-law and sister-in-law may join us. Okay, there's four of us. But wherever I'm communing during these online services, whether it be on the patio or in the living room or Clydell's living room, there's always an empty seat. And here's where the intimate moment takes place. I always envision Jesus Christ sitting in one of those empty seats conducting the Lord's Supper. And I just like, wow, I am absolute in awe that I have been invited to that Lord's Supper. We certainly know that they were reclining, that there was so much more than just the bread and the cup. Jesus was still teaching. There was the washing of the feet. And so to be invited to that in that intimate setting, it really has helped me connect and maybe even have a greater appreciation of the Lord's Supper, knowing that we have the opportunity to partake in the intimate worship of our Lord Jesus Christ through something that he did with his disciples. It deepens the moment. It's an honor that comes with responsibility, an extraordinary gift bestowed upon us because of God's grace. The Lord's Supper brings us to a place where we can experience Christ in the past, the present, and even the future. It's a time for reflection within our own hearts. Have we given everything we have to give to God? Our sins, our fears, our failures, even our hopes and desires. He wants to hear those. We can rejoice in his glory as we await his return. Our worship is deepened knowing that God might do something in us that only he can do. There is beauty in the intimacy, sitting there in our living rooms, just a small intimate group, while we take communion with him through the Lord's Supper, remembering his broken body and the blood he shed. What awaits our eager heart as we worship him with sincerity? Do we seek him boldly? Do we hesitate? He who makes each day new, he seeks us. All that is required of us is that we bring ourselves to him with a pure heart, not a perfect heart, but a forgiven one. His presence is unmistakable, and that's what I've really liked about these intimate Lord's Supper moments in my living room, on the patio, in Clydell's living room. Wow, Jesus is sitting right there in that empty chair. And as we pray and we take this moment of silence, I'm going to even offer that silence before the prayer. Just imagine Jesus is right there in your living room or wherever you're partaking of communion. Lavishly, he reveals himself. Jesus gave us the ultimate gift of salvation, reconciling us with God. We read the words of John the Baptist. Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus was without sin, but about to take on the world's sin as he sat with his disciples celebrating that Passover meal. In those moments, he was still teaching, honoring him through the Lord's Supper. We too have the opportunity to put our trust in him and learn, seeking him with gratitude and a heart of worship. His love, forgiveness, and grace are waiting to be received. So, what about you? What intimate moments do you experience through the Lord's Supper? Have we taken a different view of that intimate setting, or can we put ourselves in a good place? We are at home in our comfortable setting. That's intimate. Imagine Jesus sitting right there on the couch with you or in an empty chair. So when I say I've kind of really enjoyed communion at home, again, it's not that I don't miss the camaraderie, the fellowship of my church family. I think it means a whole lot more knowing that as I'm watching the services online, wow, I know that preacher. I know that person praying. I know that person doing communion. So that kind of helps, you know, with this distance barrier. But again, I have loved communion. And so as I pause now, just before we pray for the bread and the cup, I want you to really get intimate and just imagine Jesus right there on your patio, in your living room, in your kitchen, in your dining room, right now. Can you envision him sitting right there? So I encourage you to be intimate with Jesus as we pause for just a moment and we'll pray for the bread and the wine. Father God, we are just so happy that you are here with us. And through this whole pandemic and this new way of celebrating the Lord's Supper, again, we love our church family. We miss our church family. But we just pray that this intimate act that you so boldly proclaimed for us and invited us to partake in with you, Lord, we pray that we can be intimate. And as I mentioned, bring our whole hearts, bring our sins, bring our failures, bring our hopes, and bring our desires. And it is in your name that we pray. And thank you so much for this invitation and for being intimate with us during this time of communion. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
He came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for.
If you're looking for contentment in the things that you can't see, you're gonna have some disappointment. So won't you listen to me, please? 'Cause I know about a Savior. He came down to be a man. And when he left, he sent his Spirit. He made me everything I am.
He came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for.
Well, sometimes I make decisions that later I regret, but the Lord keeps on assuring me he's not finished with me yet. Well, I don't worry about tomorrow, and I don't worry about yesterday, and I don't worry about this crazy world, 'cause I found a better way.
He came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for. He came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for. He came down to my level when I couldn't get up to his. With a strong arm, he lifted me up to show me what living is. He'll come down to your level if you'll open up the door. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for. He wants to make your life worth living. That's what he came down for.
Welcome to all of you, wherever you may be and whenever you may be watching this. I was just thinking, can you believe this is the 10th Sunday service that we have recorded? And I know all of you, like me, are eager for us to get back together in some form of fashion of worshiping together. And I also know that we all have a little different idea about how best to do that, but we are getting closer to being able to gather together in a safe and responsible way. And actually, you should be getting an email this week that will give you more details about that. So be looking for that. In the meantime, we'll continue to try and support one another as best we can. And with that in mind, I was thinking today of one of the proverbs that says, a merry and a happy heart is a good medicine. And I thought about, before we begin our lesson today, that I'd like to try to make your heart a little merrier or happier. And I thought I'd tell you a coronavirus joke that I recently heard. Now, you understand I'm a little hesitant to tell a coronavirus joke because, as you know, for most of us, after I tell it, you'll have to wait 2 weeks to get it. And, of course, there's always a little bit of a problem about telling jokes about germs. I mean, you really don't want to spread those around too much. Okay, I'm sorry, I'll stop. No more. If I'm not careful, all these virus jokes could turn into a pandemic. Maybe we better start the sermon. Today we continue our study of the Sermon on the Mount. And today we talk about the Lord's model prayer that he gave us, the Lord's Prayer. Years ago, there was a fire on the campus of Texas Tech. It was actually at Holden Hall,
the building that my dad's office was in. People were concerned because in the rotunda of Holden Hall is a very famous and a very treasured mural that was painted by the internationally known painter Peter Hurd. And the mural actually did sustain a little bit of smoke damage. That evening at dinner, Dad was telling us about how he had come to work early that morning and he saw a man in white overalls standing on a stepladder trying to clean and touch up the mural a little bit. Dad was concerned. This was a prestigious work of art, and this fellow was just a guy from maintenance. And so Dad was worried that he might actually do some damage to the painting. So he visited with him a while, and eventually he decided the man probably wouldn't do too much damage. So he went off to his office. You can imagine how Dad felt when he read the headlines in the paper the next morning. Peter Hurd in town to touch up his painting. Had Dad known who he was talking to, I suspect he would have had a very different conversation with the man. How much our attitudes change when the ordinary maintenance guy we're talking to becomes a famous artist. How our conversations change. For you see, conversations reveal relationships. The way we talk to each other says much about what we think of each other. The way we talk to our closest friends is quite different than the way we talk to strangers. The way we talk to people we have a lot in common with is very different from those who we have little in common with. In his book, Prayer, the Great Conversation, Peter Kreeft discusses the meaning of prayer for Christians. He describes prayer as the greatest of conversations that we can participate in. And Kreeft helped me realize what it was about the prayers of the Pharisees and the pagans that bothered Jesus so much. I mean, if prayer is conversation, and conversation reflects relationship, then Jesus is telling us not to have the kind of relationship with God that they had and that their prayers revealed. Jesus said the Pharisees were hypocrites. They would have us believe their prayers reflected a deep devotion and love for God. But according to Jesus, prayer was only an opportunity for them to experience their own glory as they made sure other people heard their many and loud words. Their prayers focused more on them than on God. And the pagans' problem was a little different. Their prayers were what Jesus called babbling. There's actually some controversy as to what this word babbling means. The only place the word is used in the Bible is right here in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And so it's not certain just exactly what the word means. And this is evident when you look at the many different translations of the word in Scripture. Babbling on, vain repetitions, using the same words again and again, saying a flood of empty words, heaping up empty phrases, saying meaningless words, rambling on and on, just to mention a few of the translations. Well, whichever translation you choose, the idea, I think, is clear, isn't it? Those pagan prayers did not indicate a relationship with a personal God, but rather some kind of magical God that responds to magical incantations. But when one looks at the model prayer the Lord gives to his disciples, I think it is fair to say that in it we see a picture of the kind of relationship God wants with us. This prayer Jesus gives us is a conversation with God that reveals some important aspects of what our relationship with God should be. Three in particular, I think. The prayer first eliminates the precariousness of God, the uncertainty about Him. And then it also establishes the preeminence, the lordship of God. And then finally, when these two aspects of the relationship are experienced, we are able to fully enjoy the presence of God. The prayer begins, "Our Father in heaven." And that short sentence reveals two very important truths about God. Truths that were not at that time widely known about God, I don't think. And actually may not be widely known about God today. Those first two words, "Our Father." It tells us that God cares for us like a father cares for his children. When we begin our prayer, "Our Father," we eliminate the precarious uncertainty about whether or not God loves us. We are talking with someone who cares about us as a father cares for his children. But it's not just our Father, it is our Father in heaven. God not only cares for us, but he also has the power to take care of us. The phrase "in heaven" describes God's power and his authority. Our Father's reign extends to the heavens. Now, consider just how frightening an alternative relationship would be. Can you imagine living in a world, in a relationship with God, who does not care about you? What would life be like if God didn't care at all about us? Living in fear of a God who was arbitrary, or a God who had a temper. A God who, in a divine fit of anger, might decide to destroy us. A God whose actions were not ruled by his love for us. Can you imagine living with that kind of a God? Well, maybe we can. I mean, haven't we all lived at one time or another with that image of God, or at least wrestled with it? Not certain he really loves us, not really sure he cares for us like a father cares for his children. But the truth is, he loves us even more than our fathers love us. And with this prayer, Jesus is saying that the relationship Jesus wants us to have with God is even closer than the relationship we could ever have with a loving father here on earth. But maybe even more frightening than a God who doesn't care for us is a God who does care, but who doesn't have the power to take care for us. Such a God might as well not even exist. Yes, God feels our trouble. Oh, yes, he wishes we didn't have to suffer. And if he could, he would do something, but he can't, so he won't. Years ago, there was a popular book that came out by Rabbi Harold Kushner titled, "When Bad Things Happen to Good People." And there are some really good thoughts in the book, but in my opinion, it is written on a very false and unfortunate premise. Rabbi Kushner says it can't possibly be true that God is both all-loving and all-powerful. If God was all-loving and all-powerful, then bad things would not happen to good people. He wouldn't let it happen. So either God is not all-loving or God is not all-powerful. And Rabbi Kushner concludes that God is not all-powerful. But I'm telling you, the God that Jesus would have us pray to is not only a God who cares for us, he is also a God who can take care of us. Our Father in heaven eliminates the precariousness, the uncertainty of God. But then the prayer goes on to establish the preeminence of God. "Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Oh, this phrase, it is so easy to say, so familiar to us, isn't it? But this is an expression of profound submission to God. We may say it often, but living it out is very different. It is difficult to lift up his name over ours, to submit to his will, not ours. It is difficult to surrender our little empires to his majestic kingdom. Jesus' prayer teaches us it is not enough to know God cares for us and can take care of us. We must also have a relationship that acknowledges God is in control of our lives and has a right to be. His will, his name, his kingdom must prevail. And we must learn to serve in his kingdom, not to rule in our own, to submit to his will, not to insist on our own. And this is hard for at least two reasons. First of all, because our very fallen nature rebels against it. It is not our nature for God's will to take precedent over our own. That is a battle that we Christians engage in every day. But there's another reason this part of the prayer is hard. Because even if we are devoted to God, even if we were perfectly devoted to God, this would still not be easy all the time. And we know this because we have an example of one who was perfectly devoted to God, who also had a hard time with God's will. In Gethsemane, our Lord prayed, "Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. If it be possible, let me escape your will. I don't want to do it. But not my will, Lord," he goes on, "but your will be done." So you see, even if our hearts were perfect, allowing God's will to have its way, allowing God's kingdom, his rule, to be established in our lives, it's not always easy. But this is the relationship Jesus is describing for us to have. The Pharisees' prayers exalted themselves. They established their own preeminence. By their own authority, they equated their traditions, their opinions, their beliefs with the teaching of God that they had through the prophets of Moses. Their will was as important, perhaps even more important than God's. God willed that they live holy and pure lives, and yet their will allowed them to accommodate evil and wickedness in their hearts, according to Jesus. You know, in previous lessons, we looked at how the Pharisees twisted the law and the prophets so that their own will could take preeminence over God's. Because they made their little kingdoms more important than God's, Jesus said they made people twice a child of hell. And the pagans, they dishonored God by reducing him to merely grand projections of themselves. Their selfishness, their disinterest in others, their lust for power and pleasure. Gods that they must appease by a flood of empty incantations and rituals. You know, many of the pagan religions encouraged worship to be done under the influence of wine. They worshipped, among others, the god of wine, Bacchus, and they thought that their worship was more inspired if they were intoxicated. And this may be why the phrase spirits is often applied to wine and liquor. The ancient practice of intoxicated worship believed that the wine facilitated the inspiration of spirits. But this isn't the relationship with God that Jesus wants for us. He doesn't want us speaking to God in any way except in a way that honors his name, his will, and establishes his preeminence in our lives. Then Jesus goes on, "Give us this day our daily bread." So you see, when we eliminate our precariousness about God and establish God's preeminence over our own lives, then we can begin to enjoy God's presence in our lives. First, we can enjoy his provision for our daily bread and all of our physical needs and desires. The psalmist says that God delights in satisfying the desires of every living thing. This is the kind of God we serve. And as we get to know God and enjoy his presence in our life, we trust him more and more to take care of the needs in our life. God delights in our coming to him with requests. He doesn't want us to do it occasionally. He wants us to do it daily. I don't think God wants to arrive in a great big van and just dump out a lifetime of supplies. I think God prefers to make personal deliveries to us daily. Now, don't misunderstand. God is perfectly happy for us to work hard and put away money to take care of future needs. God doesn't dishonor that. But I wonder if occasionally God would like us to tell him what we need and then just give him a chance to supply it in a special way. I mean, is that so silly? If we need a new car, or a new refrigerator, or a new whatever, why not just ask him and give God the opportunity to just give it to us, just in case he wants to? There's nothing wrong with working hard to get something, but God is the one who provides everything. He provides us our jobs. He provides us our way to earn money. He provides us our skills, our abilities. So even if we get a new car by working hard for it, even then it's still God who is providing it. But I just want you to think, isn't it possible at times God just might like to provide for us in a different way? If for no other reason than just to remind us that he is the one who is providing. Otherwise, I think we might make the mistake that Jimmy Stewart made in the movie Shenandoah. Great movie. Yes, it's on the list. In the movie, Stewart plays a farmer who sits down for a Thanksgiving dinner with his family, and he says a prayer over the feast. Now, Stewart's character believes in God, but he doesn't yet have the relationship with God he should. Not exactly the relationship Jesus is describing. So this is how he prays. He says, "Lord, we cleared the land. We plowed it and sowed it and harvested it. We cooked the harvest. It wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be eating it if we hadn't done it all ourselves. We worked dog-bone hard for every crumb and morsel. But we thank you the same anyway for the food we're about to eat, Lord. Amen." Not quite the attitude Jesus wants. And then Jesus says, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." We also enjoy God's presence through his forgiveness. And I think this is sometimes harder for us to accept than our daily bread. But if God is our Father, and if God loves us, and we've given our lives to his care, then we can know he will forgive us our sins when we ask him. And I think sometimes we have difficulty believing God forgives us because we struggle forgiving others. So Jesus reminds us that receiving God's forgiveness becomes a problem when we will not forgive others. There's no way to receive forgiveness unless you know you need it. And when you truly know you need forgiveness, it's not quite as hard to forgive others. When we truly recognize that God has forgiven us, how can we not forgive others? No one has sinned against us anything like how we have sinned against God. Our unwillingness to forgive others is usually because we are not yet willing to admit our own need to be forgiven. So Jesus reminds us that if we want to enjoy God's forgiveness, we must recognize that we need it. And then once we recognize that, it will be much less difficult to give it to someone else who needs it from us. Then Jesus says, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." I looked at 58 different translations of this verse. 25 of them read, "Deliver us from evil." 33 read, "Deliver us from the evil one." Which is it? Both. I like the Message translation, I think, the best. "Keep us safe from ourselves and the devil." As we grow spiritually, we come to know how difficult our battle with sin and with evil really is. And one reason is that our battle is not just with our own sinful nature. Our battle is with the evil one, the devil. Peter warns us, you remember, "Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour." The Lord's Prayer reminds us that we are not alone in our battle against sin and evil. We have a Father in heaven who leads us away from evil and who is able to deliver us from the evil one. And that is a blessing we appreciate more and more as we realize more and more just how often we fall into Satan's snares. Well, daily provision, forgiveness, deliverance, that's not a bad list. The goal of prayer is for us to enjoy God. The goal of prayer is not learning how to manipulate God, not how to say the right words or mouth the right expressions. The goal of prayer is to know God, to enjoy Him, to have a conversation with Him that reflects the kind of relationship He wants to have with us as a Father, as a Lord, as our provider and friend. And I don't know about you yet, but I'm not there yet. I think most of us struggle with this at times. Prayer doesn't come easy for us. Prayer is a discipline we have to grow and grow into. Eliminating our uncertainty about God sounds fine until tragedy comes. And then we begin to wonder all over again, does God really care? Does He really love us? Or maybe God isn't powerful enough to take care of us. Establishing God's authority in our life sounds great until we desire something that is wrong or evil. Then it's not so easy to establish His preeminence. And enjoying God's presence is something we will learn more and more as we grow more and more into the Lord. As we become more of what God wants us to be. As our relationship with God becomes what He wants it to be. I don't know about you, but sometimes I wrestle with the idea that if we're not already what we're supposed to be, maybe our walk with the Lord isn't really genuine. Maybe we're not really Christian after all. C.S. Lewis wrestled with that too. And he has a quote that has helped me a lot. I want to share it with you. He says, "The disquieting thing is not simply that we skip and begrudge our duty of prayer. The really disquieting thing is that it should be numbered among our duties at all. For we believe we were created to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. And if we were perfected, prayer wouldn't be a duty, it would be a delight. So why is this not so yet for me? The very activity for which we were created is impeded by evil in ourselves and evil in other people. To practice it spontaneously and delightfully isn't yet possible for me. I must say my prayers today, whether I feel devout or not, just as I must learn my grammar today if I'm ever to read the poets." Lewis's words remind me of what Jesus said. Follow me. Why? Because you are not yet where you need to be. And if you want to get there, you need to follow me. And I will get you there. At first, our relationship with God and with Jesus is like learning grammar from school, from our teacher. But in time, we will close our grammar books and we will open the book of God's poetry and we can delight in it together. I pray our conversations with God will be increasingly more delightful and more enjoyable. Conversations that we desire as much as those with our oldest and dearest friends. And Jesus says, we can have such a conversation with our Father in heaven. A great conversation. A great relationship. That Jesus Himself has made possible for us to have. A relationship that I think is implied in this prayer Jesus taught us to pray in His Sermon on the Mount. May God bless your week to come and may you have a great time with your family and your friends. We look forward to seeing you soon.
It makes me grateful just to know that I can be unique and fill a spot beside the other three. Without a place here in the church, I know that I'd be lost. Thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause. Without a place here in the church, I know that I'd be lost. Thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause. Bum, bum, bum. Thank you, Lord, for letting me contribute to the cause.